college. Maybe he wants to say a word about that. Give him all the time he wants. God bless you. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Brother Scott. Let's turn our Bibles to Acts chapter number 1. I'm sorry, Matthew chapter number 1. Matthew chapter number 1. Now, thank you, Pastor, for your kindness. Thank you for allowing me the joy of being here last night and then returning again tonight. Now, these two fine looking young men who drove me up to Greenville, and by God's grace, you'll drive them home from Greenville to Minneapolis, are Terry Bishop. He's the chairman of our usher board at Tabernacle. And Benny Harper is my grandson, and on the staff at Tabernacle, and works with the Brightford Hour. You hear the Brightford Hour? Those tapes pass through his hands and are out to the stations day by day on schedule so that they can be heard. We broadcast over 77 radio stations across the land every day, 25 minutes a day. This is my 51st year at that job. Didn't start it last week, did I? A long time ago. And, now I'm in the first year. So we praise the Lord for the Brightford Hour daily. Some of you hear the program here in Charlotte. I appreciate that. And then down toward Kings Mountain. And then all of North Carolina, about 10 first states in North Carolina. And down in Greenville, I started back in 1943. It's good to be in your church. Thank you, Pastor. God bless you. Your kind words are appreciated. God bless you. I don't feel like I'm much of a preacher. Never have felt I'm much of a preacher. But I'm a pretty good sized man. I'm 267 pounds. More than some of you all have. And but up here, I don't have quite that much, I don't think. But down here, I have a lot more than that. But it's kind of hard to get it out of my mouth and say what I want to say. Sometimes difficult to know exactly how and what to preach. As you preach so long, I've been in it 54 years. And I'd like to stay in it a few of the years if I could. And I preach in my kind friend. We have one of our graduates. God bless you. You shake hands with Benny?
Yeah.
Good. So glad you all here tonight. And the Tabernacle, we have preacher school. This is our next year. We are our 31st year. And we appreciate Tabernacle Bible College in business and training preachers and other personnel for the Lord's work, missionaries in particular. We have a lot of our graduates go to the mission field. Our church is a missionary church at Tabernacle. We support 423 missionaries, $10,000 a week to missions around the world. And I rejoice in that great privilege. I've been doing that for a long, long time. The main thrust of our church is missions.
Amen.
You know, I believe in evangelism. I'm not an evangelist. I've never been. I try to do the work of an evangelist, but I'm not an evangelist. In Ephesians, I'm told that God gave to the church evangelists and pastors, teachers, and on down the line for the perfecting of the saints and for the work of the ministry. And it's rather interesting to me that it doesn't make any mention of evangelism in that verse. Now, I'm not playing down evangelism. God forbid, we need a lot of that. Don't have too much of it nowadays. But a pastor is emphasized in the New Testament.
Yeah.
I think God's prime man is the pastor. There can be no church without a pastor. Now, I didn't know that when God called me to be a preacher. I didn't know what I was going to do. I just knew that God called me. But I've learned a few things about the Bible, about the ministry, and I'm convinced that the key man is the pastor. Not the evangelist, nor teacher, nor deacon, nor some outside institution, but the local church or the pastor is God's key man. He operates through that. And I believe that. A pastor's work only starts with evangelism. That's like going in the front door. Once he gets into the church and does the work of an evangelist, there are untold ministries that he's responsible for, the pastor. Buried the living, buried the dead, visiting the sick, counseling those discouraged, preaching the word of God, teaching the Holy Scriptures, leading the Sunday school effort, directing the choir. I don't literally direct the choir, but they sing what I want to sing. And sir, and I tell them they don't sing what I want to sing, I tell them what to sing. And on down the line, pastors responsibility is so great and so manifold and so varied. You didn't do anything but evangelize, you'd be very narrow.
Right.
So we have to be pastors, you know. I try to evangelize in the process. But my main thrust is that local church and the Word of God. Teaching the preaching of the Word of God is our main thrust. I think we missed that a little bit today. I hope we'll stay with the book and stay with our call to be pastors of the flock.
Yeah.
Evangelize, but be pastors of the flock. And you can't give yourself altogether to evangelism. You have to give yourself to the whole counsel of God. That's wide and varied. But I praise the Lord for my years, and I appreciate the goodness of God, and I appreciate my grandson who's now preaching, been preaching about 15 years, I think, right?
Amen.
And he's got a head start on me. He started when he was about 17, and I was 27 when I started, 25 when I started. So he's got a head start on me about 10, 12 years. That's great. And I'm going to be living long as I live, the longer to preach the Word of God in his lifetime. Thank you for the invitation to mention the book. And I brought my books with me, a few of them on the table back there that you might be interested in. Here are sermons that I preached at Tabernacle. You should be get. I have a box full of them, some 100 different ones, I guess. And this one is entitled The Fall and Ruin of Commercial Babylon. That's Revelation chapter number 17 and 18. Here's another one, What Happens When a Christian Dies. All of us concerned about that, that ought to be. And then here's the sermon on the parable of the sower. That's interesting. And then here's another sermon on the parable of the net, of the seven parables in Matthew 13. Here's a sermon on the folly of relevancy. A few years ago, that word became a quite common word, relevancy. When I first began to hear it, I couldn't even say it, let alone. Well, I'll tell you what it meant. I was a college graduate too, but it wasn't in my vocabulary. But I found out what the word means, and sure enough, a lot of churches trying to be relevant, trying to be like the First Baptist Church downtown, or down like the Episcopalian downtown. You better be like God wants you to be. A lot of preachers do that. They want to be like other preachers. But you better let that alone and do what God wants you to be, you see. So I'd recommend you hear that. Get them for $1 each. You couldn't beat that at Walmart. You don't like the sermon, erase it. You have a brand new tape. Yes, sir. There are many of them there. And then these books, this is five of my small books. I have 54 of these small ones. And this one is the phenomenon of the independent Baptist movement in the 20th century. One of the most interesting things that's ever happened in the history of the church, is the rise of the independent Baptists in our generation. Never seen anything like it in all church history. I've studied history rather extensively. I have a minor in history from Furman University. And I've never read anything quite like we've enjoyed the last 50 years among independent Baptists. What is heaven like? What is heaven like? I'm concerned about that. Where are the dead? Honest questions, vital answers. Where are the dead? A book on what about the TV? Washington is beginning to talk about that a little bit. The Shindig's Last Shenanigan, the Feast of Belshazzar. Their preacher over in Tennessee gave me that title. He's in heaven now. And then the list of all pictures of them on the back. And you can get any one you want for $1 a piece. You can get a dozen of them for $12. Or you can get a whole set of them if you want. And then these are commentaries. I have 12 commentaries. All of them in cloth bag, but I have 6 commentaries in paper bag. I have the same books in cloth bag, but these are much more economical. Here are my 2 volumes on Genesis, each one of them 350 pages. And then my book on 1st and 2nd Corinthians, 300 pages. My book on Daniel, 280 pages. A book on 1st and 2nd Peter, 1st and 2nd 3rd John. Is 210 pages. And my book on the church, 8 sermons on the church, 150 pages. Now you may have all 6 of these for $20. That comes to about $4 a piece or less. And that's a real bargain if I'm in that book. Quite expensive to have produced. And I'd be highly honored to know you had these six of my commentaries in your home. I have the other six on the table with their cloth bag, and they're quite more expensive. You may get the cloth bag if you want them. I have one on Acts, and I have one over on John, the Gospel of John, and others on the table. You may look at them at the close of the hour, if you care to. The money doesn't come to me. I receive nothing from my meetings. I give all the money I made in my meetings. The dead expense of traveling go right back into the price for hour. I didn't start that last week. I started that in 1948. And I made a lot of money preaching since 1948, but I haven't accepted a dollar of it myself. And I don't do now. I don't need it. You get 79 years old, you don't need anything but a lot of grace. So I don't need all that. Yes, sir. So I'm doing all right. Don't worry about me. I just want God to give me enough grace to finish the journey. Then I'm going home. That's going to be a good experience when it happens. Now, I'm not in a hurry necessarily. I don't plan to leave tonight, by the way. I may, but I don't plan to. But I'm going to heaven when I come to die. Well, you might not make it, preacher. I'm sure you can stop. I'm going to make it. In the good grace of God. I'm so proud to announce that to you. Now, your Bible open to Matthew chapter number 1. I want to read a few verses to you. And we stay a bit tonight. From this chapter, the Lord may lead me. I'm going to speak on the birth of Jesus Christ and some things that I find in the verses relating to his birth. Beginning with verse number 18 in Matthew chapter 1. You have your Bible? I'd like for you to look with me. Always carry your Bible to church. When I was a boy, I was in a Southern Baptist church, and I stuffed a quarterly in my pocket. When I became independent, I began carrying my Bibles to church. And the Bible much better than quarterly, that's for sure. All right, verse 18. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. Now, perk up your ears. I'm about to read an authoritative record of the birth of Jesus Christ, my Lord. Yeah. Now, I tell you the truth, I couldn't tell you an authoritative record of my birth. I don't recall it. My mother told me a few things. For example, she told me, after I've been preaching 20 years, I guess, that when I was born, she gave me to God to be a preacher. But I didn't know that until after God called me. And I asked her, why didn't you tell me that years ago? She said, I wanted God to tell you. But God did. And I'm so glad she cooperated and gave me to God to be a preacher. I couldn't have done anything else, I don't think. It was ordained that I'd be a preacher when I was born. God worked a deal with my mama like he did with Hannah in relation to Samuel. And I wouldn't be at all surprised if God didn't work a deal with many of you.
Right.
More of us are saved than we imagine because mama prayed us in. And you couldn't ever be born again. I don't believe the child of a praying mother could go to hell. You will get saved sooner or later. She might not see it, but it'll happen. She's a praying mother. It'll happen. God don't let children of praying mothers go to hell. But anyway, here's an authoritative record about the birth of a man that we know as Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Now I'm concerned about that, and actually I would be. My whole life and hope is wrapped up in Jesus. But when Christ is on the rock, I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. If I can learn anything at all about our Lord, I will learn that. Yes. And you feel the same way, I will learn that. And the fact of the matter is, we can know about him only as we learn about him in the scriptures. These scriptures are inspired of God, and they are totally authoritative. Whatever the Bible says, that's the truth. Stand upon it. Now watch the record as it gets under pole. When, as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, note the word espoused, engaged to Joseph, the arrangements had been made, the plans had been set that Mary and Joseph become married. They were engaged, we would say, and out either with a wedding, engagement ring, a sign and a symbol of that great engagement. I read something of that in verse 18. Before man that will deny that denies the Bible.
Right.
Before they came together as husband and wife,
Man. She
was found with child of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
I didn't misread that. And your Bible reads exactly like mine. If you have a King James, you don't have a King James, you haven't got a Bible.
Right.
You get rid of your Bible, get you a King James Bible. Not a King James Version, but a King James Bible. Before they came together as husband and wife, she was found a child, not of Joseph, and she was no fornicator.
That's right.
She found a child, the Bible says, of the Holy Ghost. I believe that. I'd be a foolish man not to. I believe that, and he said it with no reservations at all. Then Joseph, a husband to be, being a just man, and not willing to make a public example out of his espoused wife, was minded, he thought in his mind, about the possibility of putting her away. He had every right to do that, because he concluded that since he was not the father of the child, and he knew he wasn't, then she was a fornicator. No man up to that point had ever heard of a virgin birth. There's only been one. There'll not be another one.
That's right.
And Joseph had every right in the world to believe that Mary was a fornicator at that point. And he said, I don't want to embarrass her. He evidently loved her a great deal. He said, I don't want to embarrass her. Knew I want to be embarrassed myself. And he thought to himself, how can I put her away with least publicity, and least fanfare, with least embarrassment? And while he thought about those things in verse number 20, and while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord, the angel of the Lord appeared unto Joseph in a dream and said, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. Now here are two times in two verses that the Bible clearly says that Mary was conceived by the Holy Ghost. Now I was not conceived by the Holy Ghost. I know who my father is. And he was a good father, a good man. And none of you were conceived by the Holy Spirit. I think every conception is of God. God knows about every conception. When a woman conceives, God says, live! And that moment, that new baby is born, a new conceived baby begins to live. I went to church 9 months before I was born.
Amen.
I was just as much what I am now before I was born than I was when I was first conceived. Right? And God said, live. A woman can't have a baby except God gives her conception.
Sure.
I read in Ruth chapter 4, the Lord gave Ruth conception.
Yeah.
And God gives every woman, every prospective mother, conception. Right? And so Mary was conceived of the Holy Spirit. Now one time is enough for me and you to say, amen, amen, we believe that. A lot of skeptics around Charlotte and Greenville who don't. And so the Lord not one time, but twice in two verses, said that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. Now let every man be alive, and God's word be true.
Amen.
I accept that, and I want you to do the same thing without any reservation. Now look at verse 21. And she shall bring forth a son. She shall bring forth a son. Does your Bible read that way?
Amen.
Now I noticed that your man leading the singing has three girls. He may have some more, but he sure got three fine girls, beautiful children. Right? Many a mother has had a daughter. My wife produced two daughters and one son. And it makes no difference after they get here whether it's a girl or a woman, make a little difference out of it. I love my granddaughters and my daughters, and I only have one daughter living, I have one in heaven, just as much as I do my grandson or my son. Not a bit of difference, not at all. A man's greatly endowed to have daughters. Right, a son's either one. But here's a mother who couldn't have a daughter. She had a son.
Right.
Many a mother has twins. Right. My son had twins, one girl, one boy. But a medium of it has two boys at one time. And we had a couple in our church a few years ago who had three boys at one time. What about the three? My brother had a son who had three boys at one time. I told my brother, my civil rights have been violated. It's not fair for any man to have three at one time when we only had one at one time. But he was a mother who couldn't have twins, nor triplets, nor even a good daughter. And she should bring forth a son, single son. God fixed that, just like he fixed your birth and my birth, except this is a divine operation. And the verse goes on to say, and thou shalt call his name Jesus. Here is a mother not permitted to name her child. Now that's a big privilege when a baby is born. One of my grandsons is planning to have a baby about November, December, right, Benny?
Right.
Have they picked out a name yet?
No.
Not yet? Well, I'd like to have them out. I like that idea of naming one of my grandsons, a great-grandson, this would be. But I probably won't have that privilege. Yeah, but here was a mother of all people who would enjoy that privilege to be the mother, but not this mother. God named that baby in heaven. And the angel said, thou shalt call his name Jesus. So he not only delivered a baby, but gave the name along with it. And the name Jesus means Savior. It's the same name as Joshua in the Old Testament. Jesus, Savior of my soul. He's the one altogether lovely. And we make much of that name, don't we? And here's where it was found. First, God gave it. For he shall save his people. This is the reason. Because he shall save his people from their sins. Now, we Baptist people believe in eternal life. And Pentecostal people and Methodist people kind of jive at us because we believe what we call once saved, always saved. But I do believe in eternal life. But the Methodists and the Pentecostals say, now, that's a license to commit sin.
No.
If you say, are saved eternally, you can get drunk and you can't lose your salvation. Or you can steal and you can't lose your salvation. Baptists don't believe that. I don't believe that.
That's right.
If a man be in Christ, he's a new creation.
Amen.
Old things pass away, and behold, all things become new. If there is no difference in your life now than before you were converted, you didn't get salvation.
Right. Amen.
No. God makes a new creature out of you. All things pass away. Right. So it's no license to quit sin at all. But we do believe that you're saved eternally, everlastingly. God, Jesus, saves his people, not in their sin, but from their sins. And you're a new creature upon being born again. Look at verse 22. Now all of this was done that it might be fulfilled that was spoken of by the Lord, by the prophet Isaiah, who said, behold, a virgin shall be with child. A virgin. Your Bible reads that way too, doesn't it?
Yeah.
King James, it does.
Yeah.
Behold, a virgin shall be with child. Now, it's really no miracle for a young woman to have a child. But it is a miracle for a virgin to have a child. Right?
Right.
My wife had three, and my mother had five. And no sin committed, nothing wrong, it's just normal as it can be. But every one of those children had a natural father, and my mother was not a virgin. She was conceived by my father. But Mary was a virgin when our Lord was born.
Right.
Right. She had never known a man until after the Lord was born. Then she had other children by Joseph. But up until that time, she had no other child, no other conception. She was a virgin, a perfect virgin. The new Bible has changed the word virgin to woman, a young woman. But Isaiah, inspired of God, wrote down, behold, a virgin shall be with child. He wrote that 740 years before Jesus was born. And don't you imagine there was a great deal of controversy from Isaiah's day down to Bethlehem's hour about the word virgin? I can see after Isaiah had died and a young scribe is copying his scrolls, and he's copying along, and he sees the word virgin, he lays his pen down and scratches his head, and he says, now, your brother must have had a bad case of arteries, a heart of the arteries. He should have known better than that. And I can imagine this young scribe says, I'll change it for him. And he backs up, changes to your moment, and God said, lay it off! And he let it alone. And I would be all tried that it happened many times from Isaiah's day down to the birth of Christ. But it was never changed until 1881 by Westcott Howard.
That's right.
Never changed. No. Now the new Bible says, young woman, that's one of the reasons I'm putting the stock in it.
Right.
It's a denial of the virgin birth of our Lord. And they don't stop with that one denial. There are many that they deny, miracles that they deny. The modernists they are. And I have no stock in modernism. I'm a Bible believing fundamentalist. I've always been, shall always be. For a virgin shall be a child and shall bring forth a son. And I emphasized that a moment ago. And they shall call his name Jesus, which is being interpreted God with us. They call his name Emmanuel, which is being interpreted God with us. Now, look at the next verse. Then Joseph, being raised from sleep, he was awake. The angel does most of the talking in these last four verses. But when he was awakened, he did as the angel commanded him, and took Mary to be his wife, and knew her not, until she had brought forth her firstborn son, and they called his name Jesus. Isn't that a beautiful record? Wonderful record. I'm so proud that I know that as a fact. Jesus. I would that I could describe it. I feel totally inadequate to tell you all I'd like to say about our Lord Jesus Christ. Indescribable, one altogether lovely, fairest among 10,000, the ever bright and morning star, the eternal one, the Alpha and Omega, Jesus, totally sufficient to redeem and to satisfy Adam's fallen race by faith in his work at Calvary. I can't describe him, but he's altogether lovely. You believe me, and you do believe me, I'm sure. Now, I'm saved tonight. I don't know that I deserve to be, but I am. I'm saved by his grace. There was a day when I accepted that which Jesus did for me as my own gift. 70 years ago when I was a boy. And it's still good till this hour. It's better and better as the years go by. I'm saved by grace. I provided the sinner, God provided the grace, and I'm saved till this hour. But I want to call to your mind three things that I'm not saved from. That sounds like a paradox, doesn't it? Talk about the Lord, great and wonderful, salvation, sure, and yet now you say three things you aren't saved from. What could it be? That's straight. No, I remind you of those three things. I say, first of all, I am not saved from suffering. I sometimes suffer. And not one of you in this building saved or saved from suffering yet. We sicken, we die. One of the heartaches of a pastor, and a pastor has many heartaches, like anybody else. Now, this world may be wonderful, and it is, I've enjoyed living, but it's not without grief, suffering, and sorrow. But one of the sorrows of a pastor's life is seeing his people suffer. I had one of them, I was operating on yesterday with a heart bypass, a dear woman. Because that had come for yesterday, I haven't seen her yet. Now, one of the workers in the church has seen her, but I plan to see her tomorrow. But I hate to see my people suffer that way. Had another dear lady in the hospital in Easley who has some kind of fractured backbone. And the doctor did nothing for her. She's an older woman. I regret to hear that. I regret it sincerely. And other things happen that brings grief to my soul. And then many of them die. I've buried, since I've been in Tabernacle, more than 400 of my people. We have 3,500 members. And in those years, I've buried 400 of them. And I've never buried one that didn't break my heart after. So. That's the sorrow of a pastor. And then I look at my own life, and I suffer. I rebuke that, but I have some problems. And not a great deal. I'm feeling good right now. I have myasthenia gravis. So you know what that is, or you don't know what that is. It's the failure of the automatic muscular system in your body. Your eyes are both still automatically. My right eye sometimes will close. And that's one of the symptoms. And sometimes I lisp. My tongue won't work right. That's one of the symptoms. And exhaustion is another symptom. I stay tired all the time. My legs are giving away. And that's a symptom of myasthenia gravis. No cure for it. No pain involved. I have to take medicine 3 times a day to keep going. But praise the Lord, I've had it 10 years, still going. Amen. Praise the Lord. I was in my doctor's office Tuesday this week, and he said, "You look good. See me in 6 months. And I wanted to say hallelujah, praise God. 6 months. Save me a little money and had time. Give me a little more hope. 6 months. But anyway, I suffer like anybody else suffer. And you're going to sicken someday and suffer. The Pentecostal tell you that if you suffer, you got sin in your life. Don't you believe that?
Amen.
Don't you believe that? Not necessarily so. Everybody will suffer.
Amen.
If you've never been to a doctor, get ready, you're going. Never been a hospital patient, you're bound to be. You're bound to be. I've been to the hospital so many times until they know it when I walk in. They say, "Give me a card." I give them a card going in. That's the advantage of being old. You get a Social Security Medicare card. Some of you have one, most of you don't. You live to be 65, they'll give you one. And you go to the hospital when you need to. That's wonderful. Wonderful. But you're going to sicken one day. No indication you're not saved at all. An indication that your body is weak. I'm not saved from something. Then it reminds you also that I'm not saved from sickness. We have, I guess, 200 of our people at Tabernacle Little Shelly. Some never walk to church again. Some never come to church till they bring their body down the aisle to carry them out to bury them. They suffer, they're sick. I and the lady had heart surgery yesterday. And last week had a man had his neck veins operated on. He probably died if he didn't have done that. But things like that occur to save people. I'm saved, but I'm not saved from sickness. I'm not saved from suffering. And then third, I'm not saved from sorrow. You're going to weep. For years, I said in the pulpit when I was young, like my grandson, I've never wept. And I was telling the truth. I never wept or sobbed in my life. My family's well, no deaths, and I'd never been really broken in sorrow. But on June the 13th, 1951, a truck man, while I was preaching in High Point, in your state, drove into the back of my automobile and killed my child. One reason I love those three girls of yours, the biggest one just beside the one I lost. She died before we got home. Now my son was with me, he was just 15 years old then. We drove home as fast as we could, she died in Spartanburg. And my family's broken. And a year and my wife was killed, she stayed in the hospital 6 months. Sorrow. In a moment I was plunged into a valley out of which you never emerge, never. It's fresh in your mind almost. Every time I go to the cemetery in Woodlawn in Greenville, I think about that. I have that child buried there. And it gets on me. And bothers me. Sorrow. I know something about it. It's not easy when you're broken. And you wonder why. You say to yourself, how can I go on? How can I go on? Except by the grace of God, you probably wouldn't. But God's grace is sufficient. And I buried my child on Friday. And I preached to my people on Sunday while my wife was in the hospital at the point of death in Frankfurt. God gives you grace. God gives you grace. And I said, I don't think I can stand it. I was in Danville in a meeting. I ate breakfast with the pastor. He opened a newspaper and there was a man prostrated over a little child who had been hit with a car. And I said to the pastor, that was me, I think I died. And a few weeks ago it was me, except I was spared seeing it. I was in High Point. I didn't have to see that. and I'm glad I didn't get to see it, didn't have to see it. Some people aren't even spared that. And in a few weeks I was in the same valley, but I didn't die. I tell you the story, I tell you that God's grace is sufficient, even in sorrow and death and disorder. Now, a few people wrote to me, two or three letters, said, we thought you were a hypocrite, and now we're convinced you were. How cruel can people be? How heartless can some people be? I don't think I'd have enough brass to write that to anybody living at that moment. God forbid. Well, of course, I threw the letter away. I don't even remember who wrote it, because it was real to me. And whoever wrote it, I knew was being foolish and uncouth. God forbid I was broken. But I'm saved. I was saved then as I am now. But I had to sorrow, like many people. It may sound strange and it's a paradox, but it's a fact. And you know it's a fact. We're saved, but we're not saved from sickness, from suffering, from sorrow. Now, on the other side of the ledger, three things I am saved from. And I can be just as dogmatic about these three positive things as I am about the negative. Three things I'm saved from. First, I'd like to say that I'm saved from self. I'm not my own.
Amen.
I'm bought with a price. To use the terminology of Paul, I'm a bond slave to Jesus Christ, my Lord. And I publicly own it and confess it. Somebody said, I'm 21, an American. I'll do as I please. Get saved and all that's gone.
Right. Amen.
You don't do what you please to do. You do what he wills that you do. And he'll make you happy doing what you think you could never do.
Okay.
I'm not wrong. That's one reason I'm up here tonight. I've been doing what I'm doing right now for a long time. I can't just stay. Up and down these highways, I know the roads of North Carolina like I know my backyard. I've traveled most of the time alone. In recent years, these young fellows are 50-something. But I've driven up 85 at the midnight hour while you were sleeping. I was down 85, one or the other. And all down in South Carolina, I was driven up on the State Highway number 9 through Lancaster down toward Florence and Dillon many times on Saturday night. And I just done it all my life. Because I'm not my own. I've had a door. God's given me a door. And I must step into that door. Well, you're not much of a preacher. You don't have to tell me that. I know that. You haven't done a great deal of good. I'll agree with that. Not nearly what I'd love to have done. Well, you haven't won many people to God. I'll agree with that. But a few, praise God, a few. But I've had the sweet consolation that's what God wants me to do. And Brother Scott, I'd rather be right here tonight than any place I know. I'd rather be here than to be my wife. That's saying a great deal. She's at home, not well. 1 year younger than I am. And I need to be there. But down through these years, she's been mom and daddy both to my children. Been a good wife. Never complained about me being gone. Time to come to go, she said, go. Many a time when I didn't feel that she was able for me to go, she said, go. You have an appointment, go meet that appointment. I'm saved from self.
Yes.
Saved from self. And I'm glad it's that way. I'm glad that I can be a bondservant to Jesus. He's done so much for me. I want to do all I can for him.
Amen.
I want to live for him. I want to sing about him. I want to preach about him. I want to tithe. I'm a tither.
Yeah.
Have been all my Christian life. Tither. Then I want to be faithful witness and preaching.
Amen.
I want to expound these scriptures. Nothing thrills me more than to take this precious book and teach my people the Word of God. And this is my workbook. This has been through many dangers, toils, and snares. I don't know what I'd do without it. It's a Scofield or King James. I love it. It's not worth a dime to you, but it's worth everything to me. I want to be faithful to this book.
Amen.
Amen. I'm saved from sin. I have no selfish ambition. I want his name to be glorified in my life. But then the second thing I'm saved from is shame. I'm saved from how I feel about shame. I don't mind bearing the reproach. And there is a reproach in Jesus.
Right.
You walk with him, there is a reproach. Not everyone in Charlotte will think well of you if you're a Bible believer, separated, dedicated to the God, putting things in the world out of your life. You won't be popular. There's a certain shame. Moses chose rather to suffer the affliction of the people of God than to enjoy the pleasure of sin for a season. He knew that there was a shame in the cross, and there is. There's a shame in this book. But God gave me grace, and I'll bear that to God's glory. And then I'd like to remind you also that I'm saved from Satan.
Amen.
Satan.
Amen.
And sin.
Hear that?
I'm not a practicer of evil. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as God is righteous. Whatsoever born of God sinneth not. And the reason you don't sin is because the seed of God remains in you, and you cannot sin because you're born of God. You couldn't live and practice sin as a believer. No way. Now that's not that you don't have the potential of one sin or falling into sin, but it'd be utterly impossible for you to practice sin. If you started practicing sin as a believer, in that same presence of John chapter 5, there's a sin of the dead. And many a believer has sinned the sin which is in the dead. And John said, when a believer sins in the dead, don't pray for him, because he won't be healed, he's going to die. And many a believer has died having committed sin of the dead. So I'm saved from Satan. The devil can't touch me. I wouldn't boast about that preaching. I wouldn't either, except in Jesus. He'd like to kill me, but he can't. Except God gives him permission. We're hedged in like Job.
Yeah.
We're hedged in.
Thank
he
God.
Walks with us and talks with us and tells us where we're on our zone. I preached it years ago up in little Switzerland on top of the mountain in your state. And one of the members had bought himself a new convertible Pontiac, 1955. It was a beautiful car. And he said, I want to carry it to your meeting sometime. And I said, okay, Saturday night, you can drive me to my meeting. And I rode up there in that nice, pretty car, enjoyed it so much. And we had the service, and I was preaching like I'm preaching now. And the devil seemed to say to me, before you get off this mountain, I'll kill you tonight. And he said that so convincingly until I trembled in my boots almost. But I continued my sermon, said nothing about it. The anybody, even my buddy who was driving the car. But when the service was over, we started off the mountain, I said to myself, if the devil's threat was real, I'd like to be at the steering wheel. So I said, let me drive your car. He thought he was going to drive your car. I didn't tell him anything about it. But I drove off the mountain expecting to meet the devil around any curve. There's plenty of love there. But we rode all the way to Greenville, and I put the car in the drive and turned the switch off. And I said, hallelujah! And my deacon said, what in the world, preacher? Then I told him.
Hey.
And he hollered, hallelujah. I thought, what happened? And I said, the old devil, what a lying rascal he is.
Amen.
He can't touch you nor me. I'm saved from Satan.
Amen.
And you are too.
Amen.
I belong to Jesus. And he's the shepherd, the keeper of my soul. And he'll sustain you. He'll keep you. He'll carry you through if you'll let him.
Amen.
Don't rebel against him. Just walk with him. He'll carry you through.
Amen.
And present you one day faultless for the throne of God's grace with exceeding joy. Thou shalt call his name Jesus. I'm not glorying in myself, but I'm trying to glory in the cross of Jesus,
Amen.
My Lord.
Amen.
And glory in his name. All I need, I find sufficiently.
Thank God.
Amen. Our Father, we thank you for this text of Scripture.
Amen.
in Matthew chapter 1. Thank you for the record that we believe confidently about the birth of Jesus, of a virgin. Thank you for his death upon the cross to be our sin there. Then thank you that I've been able to tell this story these years. For one other time, I bless your name that I've had the privilege to take a text and talk about the Savior. Now I pray for South Charlotte Baptist Church, Brother Scott, and his work, and his deacons, and his people. I pray you'll bless them and use them in this area to the glory of Jesus our Lord. And we'll give you thanksgiving for all that thou wouldest do for this our brother. And these young folk from Pensacola, bless them, I pray. Give them a safe journey back to their destination. Victory to their souls. And help us as we drive to our place to go tonight. And with thanksgiving, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Brother Scott, if you'll take it that one, please.
Amen. Let's stand together. Turn number 278. Number 278.